Hello, lovely people. This is Dr. V again on the Burnout Show, and I bring you another exciting guest. Kelly Carius is with us from Alberta. And she is an award-winning social worker, mediator, and author. You've written several books, but the one behind you is one of them, No Such Thing as a Bully, correct? And I'm so fascinated by the subject that I asked Kelly to be on the show, because I know being bullied at work is one of the triggers that can lead people to lead to professional burnout. And that is my passion. I'm on a mission to save 1 million lives from burnout. And I love prevention. So if Kelly can give us some tips on how we deal with bullies at work, because everybody will come across it at some stage in your life, and you're probably already I think most people see bullies in school and things like that. But even as an adult, it's still really hard to not lose your soul when you maybe your boss tries to force you to do things that you feel are inappropriate. That's just my own experience. But I'll ask Kelly now to first tell us, Kelly, why is this like your passion? Why is this like your top subject?
Thank you. First of all, thank you so much for having me. There are a couple of reasons that I wrote No Such Thing as a Bully, and one is my own childhood bullying story, and then another bullying story as an advocate in schools, and then yet another story about being bullied at work, even while I was doing this kind of work and working in a place where you would think, you know, that shouldn't happen. People in this workplace should be healthy enough that, you know, that bullying doesn't happen. But it does. It's pervasive. And so as I was having these experiences, I was thinking about how, you know, you can't generally just kind of go up to an adult or go up to your boss, or in one of my cases, it was a director of education, go up to that person and say, you're a bully, and expect that to have any kind of effect, because it just doesn't. And so with No Such Thing as a Bully, I'm kind of reframing bullying. I'm reframing our perception of what it is and giving a new definition. And so we really, in No Such Thing as a Bully, are looking at victim responses and bully actions. Okay. And how are we using them, and how are the people around us using them, and then strengthening ourselves so that we just are not affected when it happens.
It's awesome. I really need to hear this, because it happens to me over and over again in my career, especially I think because I'm a very powerful woman and I'm really good at what I do, and that creates some animosity. And also, sexual harassment at the workplace happens a lot, and whenever I speak up, you can forget to ever work here again. I've even been told by one of my bosses, if you don't do what I say, which was an unethical thing to do, I'll make sure you will never work in this country again. So the threats are huge. And how can you avoid these circumstances, or what do you do if people put you under pressure like that? So go ahead and give us your three golden nuggets.
I have some golden rules. So one is to look at an internal sort of intention check when you are responding to things. And so an example of this is one of my situations. I was being bullied, and I thought, well, I will just, you know, take care of this problem with ultra kindness, and I did, and it did take care of the problem. But within me, I was like, see, I show you, which kind of defeats the purpose of smoothing the waters over, because you're still sitting with that internal angst. Point about resolving bullying is for you to live in peace. It's not about the other person. So, yes. So kind of that internal intention check is important. And then when you're really in the mud with it, record keeping. And this, you know, it sounds sort of boring, I guess, and maybe even a little bit like something that can hold you back. But if you are writing down incidents and who witnessed them and, you know, what happened and why it was bad, then it becomes easy to go back and say, these are the things that have happened. And this is why I'm feeling so distressed. And if you're not keeping those records, sometimes it's like sort of the sense of I don't even know what's happening to me. It feels bad, but I don't know if it's really as bad or am I just making it out to be worse? And so that solid record keeping can really
I love help. That. And that's something that I've never done because often there are heaps of witnesses. The question is, will those witnesses speak up for you? Because they might also be bullied into losing their work or their career. So yeah. I've never taken it that far, but that's an excellent idea. Because yeah. So many things that happen, you can't just remember everything because often negative experiences, you try and repress it. I remember that once during hypnosis, something surfaced that I completely forgotten about a bully situation. And I thought, oh, this has been like dominating my life subconsciously for 10 years. And I completely suppressed the memory. Once it's in the open, and that's part of the work that I love doing when I do journey, is to find these memories that are often suppressed, which are damaging you from the inside out. And when we deal with it, I mean, usually it's about let the anger out, because I'm sure there's some suppressed anger there. And then we do a whole like forgiveness process and see things from both sides. And I'm sure because you want to look at the classification bully in a different way. So how would you do the classification? Because if you look from the eyes of the bully, usually they're very insecure, anxious people too, and they just try and stay in control. So what is that? Can you tell us a little bit more about their viewpoint?
Yeah, for sure. So the way that no such thing as a bully looks at things, and this is the third nugget, regardless of which end of the scale you're on, what do I need to be strengthened enough so that I am not using bully actions and I am not using victim responses? So if I'm not using victim responses, that essentially means that I'm not being affected by the bully actions. There's always going to be people around us who are using bully actions in some kind of way. And really, if we are strong enough that just rolls off of us, then it's not really bullying. It's somebody just trying to use bully actions, but not getting very far. Mm-hmm. So the strengthening things that I look at are things like your thought processes. Are you giving yourself any negative information about yourself, or are you giving yourself information about needing to have power, needing to have control if you're on the end of using bully actions? So, you know, sometimes those messages are like, oh, I'm losing control. Oh, that person is doing a better job at work than I am. You know, and which are also weak sort of victim-based messages. And so, you know, as human beings, we need to really look at that and what have we taken on from our childhood? What have other people said to us that we've allowed to become defining pieces of our lives, and really start going, okay, well, there's that thought. What's true about it? What's not true about it? What's another way to think about it? And start balancing out those thoughts that sometimes keep us in a weak sort of place.
Yes, but what do you do in the heat of the moment? Because, I mean, I think when I get bullied as an adult, I kind of probably get pushed back into a childhood victim position. But I don't like being victimized. So my reaction is actually like I would love to like hit you in the face. But then my adult steps in and says, that's not going to go down well. I'm going to be ultimately, you know, the loser. Well, physically I could maybe win, but ultimately it's not going to end well for me. I don't know what can I do in the moment, because I've tried walking away, but sometimes they just lock the door on you and you can't walk away. if it becomes into a screaming competition, what do you do? and I've tried the kindness also, like, I completely understand where you're coming from and I feel you and let's talk about it. I've tried that also. But people who are in that anger state, they don't listen to that anymore, because actually they are feeling like a little toddler at that stage, and all they can do is like, ah!
So when I was doing the anger, and this is why I say we have to self-evaluate, I didn't care if that other person got angrier. I was like, yeah, but I'm being kind. So, you know what, however you react is fine. And so that's why, you just got to check that sort of internal intention clock. In that moment, and this is something that I talk about with kids and with adults, you have to breathe. And you have to manage your fight or flight response. And so that doesn't come, you can't just be like, okay, the next time that happens, I'm going to breathe and practice my fight or flight response. You have to practice those things when you're out of that situation so that you're ready for it when you come into that situation. And then the other thing that we don't do a lot of, and we could do so much more of it with ourselves and our kids, is just some role play practice. You know, we kind of know, like, when we're in that situation, there's a little bit of us that is like, I know that if I say this, this is what's going to happen. You know, I'm going to say I did this work, and this person's going to say, no, you didn't, I did. And I know that that is coming. I know that that's going to get my fight or flight response going. And so ahead of time, with somebody who is a kind and good person in your life, just role play it and practice it. Things like domestic violence, let's say. If I'm on the street corner and down the street, I see an incident of domestic violence. If I've rehearsed in my head what I'm going to do in that situation, I'm going to act way more smartly than if I've never even thought about it. Mm-hmm. And so really just that planning ahead of time makes a huge difference for people. And then that breathing and really being aware personally of how a fight or flight response affects us, because it's a little different for everyone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, this is very interesting. This brings you actually, what can you do as an outstander when you see any form of bullying or violence happening? How can you safely get involved and do something useful there?
Yeah, you know, we do need to know what our limits for getting involved are. So an example for me is, I worked at a place where at one point all of the staff boycotted a supervisor's retirement party. They didn't tell me about it because they knew that I wouldn't go along with it. I knew that if I brought it up as something that was not okay, that would affect the rest of my time working there. So I had a decision to make. Is this where I want to be working? Is it worth it for me to bring it up and say, you know, adios, I am leaving to go do this other work? And in that situation for me, it was. For some people, it's not going to be. So that is a very personal decision. And so we do need to think about, before we decide how we're going to openly approach something, we do need to think about, you know, what is that risk to me, and how much risk am I willing to absorb right now? And so sometimes that being a good bystander is about stepping out and loudly saying what's happened to someone else. But sometimes it's about quietly saying, hey, I saw that, are you okay? Mm. And sometimes it's about asking, hey, I saw that, what do you want me to do? How, because just because I want to speak out, that doesn't mean that other person is ready for me to do that. So there's these dynamics and sort of strategic question asking that we can do of ourselves and others to decide how to proceed.
I'm not sure what it's like where you work, but I think legally, me as a doctor in the UK, I'm supposed to report if I see anything where I think another person is in danger from physical or emotional abuse. So yes, that is possible. But yeah, you're right. Often when I talk to victims of abuse and I try and help them and motivate them to report and go to the police and things like that, often they don't, and they end up back with that abuser being abused again. And then they come back to me with another eye injury. It's frustrating. Yeah. But there should really be a number we could call where somebody actually answers the phone, because in previous workplaces, they have like a bully person that you phone, but they're usually busy doing something else. And in the heat of the moment, you still feel completely alone and abandoned. So I have not had any good experiences with that. And the last time it happened, somebody advised, said like, why didn't you push the alarm button? You know, in hospitals, they have this red emergency button when then they come with a trash trolley to do like CPR on you. I thought this is a bit over the top because those people are busy saving somebody else's life at the moment. So there's no real, yes, you see, that is still lacking in a lot of places, I find, that you can actually find somebody to help you in the moment, because what you do there and then, it will have consequences for the rest of your career at that workplace. So,
This is a gap that I've seen in work with youth and in work with adults. And one of the things that we say about youth, and maybe it's true about adults too, is that they'll reach out and ask for help three times. And if they don't get it, they'll handle it themselves in whatever way that means. And sometimes that is a violent, tragic kind of way, you know, sometimes against self or against others. And so we do need to catch that. And one of the things that no such thing as a bully is really meant to provide is some answers to that. So when someone comes to you and says, this is what I'm experiencing, here's what we can do about that. Even if all it is taking care of what's happening to you and dealing with yourself internally, even if you can't change anything that's happening outside yourself, it's still helpful to have a guide and some ideas about, okay, then how do I strengthen internally so that this situation has less of an effect on me?
Yes, I love that. That is so true. And a lot of people don't realize you can't really change your environment, but you can change how you react to what's happening in your environment.
Yeah.
Like the rule number one in coaching and also the work that you do, I'm sure. All right. Well, I think we have we've discussed a lot of valuable tips from your side. And we see the title of your book there that people, I'm sure, can find somewhere. How can people reach you if they want to work with you?
So hit up the website, nosuchthingasabully.com. There's some free downloads there if you want to just kind of stay in touch with what we're doing. If you want to get a little bit more in depth, there is a couple of Facebook pages that you can get involved in. Just search No Such Thing as a Bully and you will find me. You can also just reach me through Facebook and Facebook messaging, just facebook.com/kelly.carius.
Excellent. I'll make sure the contacts are in the show notes under the video. And I thank you again for your time. And I'm looking forward to reading your book.
And I yours. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much.